we are supposed to have a discussion on the subject by two distinguished persons. First, we have Justice A.K. Sikri. Respected Sikri Saab retired as the senior most judge of the Supreme Court in India in 2019 and is now an international judge at the Singapore International Commercial Court. He has featured as one of the 50 most influential persons in field of intellectual property across the world. His tenure as the Chief Justice of Punjab and Haryana High Court and at the Supreme Court was marked by several landmark judgments where he upheld the tenets of judiciary and fundamental rights, women's safety, children's rights, and most of all, equality in all respects, in all aspects. In one of his judgments, he has famously said, judges have to be sensitized about securing out speedy justice in cases related to crime against women, elders, children, and discrimination against HIV-infected persons. So judges have been, Justice Sikri and like Justice Venkatachalya, have all been socially conscious of the need to improve the quality of democracy in this country. We can think of no one better to begin our discussion. May I now request respected Justice Sikri to please share his thoughts on this subject.
Thank you very much. I thank you for giving me this chance to be among this very celebrated and august audience. I start with my respect for the speaker of the day, Justice Venkatachalya, whom I always fondly call in our judicial fraternity, he is our Bhishma Pitama. And he, in fact, is Bhishma Pitama in so many ways, and he has proved it today also. And Mr. Krishnamurti, Sucheta Dalal, and all others who are listening to this webinar, which is our lecture, which is organized by you. As you rightly mentioned, Justice Venkatachalya has, in fact, covered such a broad spectrum insofar as the subject is concerned, and has taken us not only about the Indian Constitution, ethos, how democracy has to takes its shape, and what is the role of judiciary which comes to, and how it has been performed by the Indian judiciary in last 70 years. But apart from that, he even took us to the, in a way, showed us the comparative constitutionalism as well as to what has been happening in America and in UK, so other continents also, the in the manner in which he covered. It would be very, very difficult to summarize that and say about it within few minutes, which I have been given. But therefore, what I would like to do is that I'll be totally, focusing on the subject which is given, that is our judiciary delivering on its role as a sentinel on Kiwi, which is the in the changing times, so which is the subject which is given. And I think that would be better. But of course, I would like to start from what Justice Venkatachalya said in his speech. One of the very powerful statement which he made was that civil society should control political society, and office of a citizen, he gave the every citizen, the office of a citizen is most important. So therefore, it is the citizen which is the fulcrum. It is the citizen which is at the center stage of any democracy. That is, I feel, is the most important message. And if we start from there, and you see how these democracies today, when we are talking of democracies, they have we have seen from time to time different forms of governance. Be it monarch, it may be dictatorship, it may be any other form of government or governance, but democracy has been accepted now. And as Justice Venkatachalya also said, that maybe this is he quoted so many jurists on this and so many political and social thinkers who said that in a democracy, the majority rule that may not be in a way the best thing, but yes, when compared with the other kinds of systems with which we have seen from time to time, it may be so far the best or the least worst, if I say so in a negative manner. But it all starts, as I said, from the civilian and the citizens. Now, as we know, and if I talk of the political thinker who was this Thomas Hobbes, who gave us the theory of social contract. He said that, look, in when the man, we have come, from early civilization, when we were savaged and were where the jungle Raj was there, might was right. Everybody who is powerful could kill other person, could rob other person. So therefore, in a society, in such a situation, and human beings, it's a natural tendency that they will always want to want a way out of anarchy. This is very, very important thing. And therefore, it is the democracy is founded on what he labeled as a social contract or common welfare, or he gave the name Leviathan state. Now, in a Leviathan state, he said that it is better to give power to one person instead of power with each and every individual and let them govern themselves. Of course, giving power to one person, that one person, like we have seen in monarchy or other dictatorship, then they can be despotic also. But he said that it is still better than having no society which is governed by a particular system. But over a period of time, many other thinkers, they improved upon this theory of social contract, and particularly Kelsen and Hart, etc., when they said that why this best form could be, to which we come to democratic form, that it need not be the ultimate authority, need not be a human being. It can be a set of law or the constitution. That is why today in our modern democracies, without giving the time with how we traveled from that stage 200-300 years and in today's democracies. But today, what I want to say here is in a nutshell that it is not the people, it is not a person, it is the constitution which is the instrument of governance, and it is the constitution which is supreme. Even in any constitution, democratic constitution, and that is why, and therefore the power should not be with one. So therefore it is rested on basically three pillars. That is the legislature, the executive, and the judiciary. And based on which Justice Venkatachalaiah also highlighted to great extent on the doctrine of separation of powers and checks and balances. So therefore three wings of the state, they work in tandem, but then their roles are assigned. They work within those parameters which are assigned to them, but then they act as checks and balances on each other's powers also, that whether every organ is working in a manner which is there. And it is based on, as I said, on the principles which are laid down in the constitution as per the constitution. But again, the important thing which is that in all these things, legislature may make the law, executive has to execute the law, and the judges have to decide. But ultimately, in our constitution also, there is what we call power of judicial review, which is very, very important. And this power of judicial review, which is given, it is not only the judicial review of the executive power, but even the legislative power. So therefore, even an act of a parliament or a state legislature can be the validity can be challenged and can be tested on the touchstone of the constitutional principles. But then what is important is in the whole thing, when we come to this kind of governance and the social contract, based on social contract theory, is that in every constitution, as again, I will say that Justice Venkatachalaiah has remarkably covered that, the constitutionality or constitutionalism, which is the attribute of a better governance and a welfare state. And this constitutionalism is, if I, as I say, is or as I see it, is based on two fundamental aspects. On the one hand, we talk that it should be the precepts of any constitutionalism are liberal democracy, human rights, separation of powers, and governed by the rule of law, and which are the essentials of a good governance. And all this talks of, if I may say so, which is very, very important, is that limited government, the concept of limited government. And therefore, any government which is to act in accordance with the constitution, it cannot take away the fundamental or human rights of the people. And it is based again on the liberty of the individuals, which is to be, which is to be respected. And the three things, which and it is stated in our constitution itself, the three more important aspects are equality, fraternity, and liberty. And around that, and but at the same time, we have our, in our constitution part four also, which I call positive constitutionalism. And that is based on social welfare, solidarity, economic equality, and social justice, which again, Justice Venkat Chalaiya mentioned, and which we call of as a welfare state. But then the balance of the two has to be maintained. On the one hand, liberties of the people, on the their human rights of the people, they are to be protected, and there cannot be an arbitrary curtailment of that. And on the other hand, welfareism, how we achieve the social justice for all these people. Now, in a democracy, maybe there are, as Justice Venkat Chalaiya also highlighted, that majority would rule, no doubt, but then there are many pitfalls, or there are many ills of any democratic system also. But the important thing which we have seen in last, at least in last, we have seen in the history, First World War, Second World War also, when Hitler or Mussolini, who were elected persons, and how they became despotic. So even in a constitutionally elected government may act despotic, in a despotic way. This is the very, very important. And in last 15, 20 years, what has been happening in so many countries around us. And I would only quote here the message which I want to convey here. This Stephen Latimsky and Daniel Ziblatt, in their book, How Democracies Die. This is what is said, and I will read three or four sentences, and I quote, democracies still die, but by different means. But they are comparing it with earlier, it could be a coup, where army coup, or any dictatorship who comes and throw away the democracy. He says that may not be happening, but democracies still die, but by a different means. Since the end of the Cold War, most democratic breakdowns have been caused not by generals and soldiers, but by elected government themselves. Like Chavez in Venezuela, elected leaders have subverted democratic institutions in Georgia, Hungary, Nicaragua. He gives so many, examples are given. They say many governments' efforts to subvert democracy are legal in the sense that they are approved by the legislature or accepted by courts. They may even portray as efforts to improve democracy, making the judiciary more efficient, combating corruption, or cleaning up the electoral process. But it is not seen in the beginning, but over a period of time, it is realized. So therefore, in a situation like this, now we have democratic government, elected government. Yes, they have a right to govern, but at the same time, they have also to conform to the constitutional principle or constitutionalism. In the process, individual liberties, rights of minorities, and rights of other marginalized sections of the society. That is one thing. And whenever there is some infraction of this, the role of judiciary comes. And that is the topic which we are discussing today. And therefore, what again, I would say what Justice Venkat Chalaiya has said, and if I paraphrase that the two roles in a democratic system, and which is governed by constitutional democracy, the two important roles of the judiciary are, number one, to protect the constitution and the rule of law. So therefore, any onslaught on the constitution, any onslaught on the freedom of the people, etc., the judiciary has to step in. Of course, ultimately, power is with the society, with the civic society, and in the election may take place. That has been happening in any democracy. If some government is not functioning properly, the people can overthrow. But then during the period, when a particular government is elected, how to save the constitutional rights, and at the same time, how to again bring about the egalitarian society, that becomes the important thing. And therefore, it becomes the duty of the any judiciary or Supreme Court or High Courts in Indian context to uphold the or to protect the constitution and the rule of law. And the second function is to bridge the gap between the law and the society. I'm not touching upon the second aspect. So therefore, in this context, it is to be seen what is the role which the judiciary has played in last 70 years. And three things which Justice Venkat Chalaiya, and we'll see, and whatever the question answers are, then we will answer to that, which have become very important, is that the first, access to justice, then the Indian judiciary in the form of PIL, which it started, then the public law principle, introduction of that public law principles, and with constitutional morality, where he quoted Professor Bakshi and said that judicial leadership, which has been taken as an act of judicial duty, and environmental protection, etc., and making playing a role from adversarial to inquisitorial system in order to advance justice. And on that, judgments which have been quoted by Justice Venkat Chalaiya from time to time, I need not repeat that. But what I want to say at the end is that, look, Indian Supreme Court or Indian judiciary has seen its ups and downs in last 70 years. We started in the beginning from 1950, say, to 1973, 1974, when judiciary was acted in little in a conservative manner during that period. Then came the emergency, where ADM Jabalpur was one judgment which is always seen as one of the black spot in the Indian judiciary, which fortunately stands overruled now. But then after the emergency, total transformation came at the end. It was not only transformation in the Indian judiciary, but the constitution was also a transformative constitutionalism. All those factors were brought with the kind of judicial activism with which the judiciary worked, and the principles which, as I said, PALs and role as a public law principle introduction, and adversarial to inquisitorial, Justice Venkat Chalaiya has said and has given all those judgments. Now the question is whether it is continued and it is sustained. We know of late there is again some criticism of the Supreme Court so many reasons. There are some issues which have I'll only flag those issues which have been raised, that all that is whether okay even today the court is protecting the rights of the people, but whether it is doing it selectively. Now, and other thing is power of the contempt, which is used by the court, whether it is justified. Role of the master, role of the Chief Justice of India as master of the roster, whether it is this role is being discharged in an objective manner, or there is some criticism to that, and whether the Supreme Court or the other courts are acting selectively by not taking some of the issues which are very, very important, and sidelining or playing the role of a procrastinating institution, not giving them the priority, but giving priority to other cases. So therefore, these may be the things, but if I may say at the end, and of course thereafter, whenever there are question answer session, we will reply to that, that maybe, you see, at the end of the day, it may be that PIL or over activism which judiciary indulge into, which Justice Venkatachalaiah also said, maybe is an invitation for all this kind of criticism. Because with this, although it has done wonders for the welfare of the people in this country, no doubt about it, but then enlarging the scope of PILs only from marginalized section of the society for the poor and illiterate and access to justice by broadening the locus standi rule with which it started, and going to the intervening in every kind of political matter or policy decisions also by and in the process becoming over activism, whether because with this the expectations of society has also gone high. Now it is not, the judiciary cannot act as a catalyst. Ultimately, change in the society, if it has to come, it has to come from other sources. It is not that it is the role of the judiciary. So what kind of role judiciary should play, and whether it is, it's because now in spite of so many judgments even now coming, which are really wonderful judgments, at the same time there are some section of the society which will look into only those aspects of the judiciary and will criticize where it has not been able to perform the role that too according to them. So that is here, and some of the issues which I have highlighted, I think the system has to be devised how to prioritize the case. It should not remain that kind of opaque system which is perceived when the criticism comes. So on the whole, my conclusion is the judiciary has been able to play that role over a period of time. If we see all that 70 years role as a sentinel on TV, on which I entirely agree with my Honorable Chief Justice R. Bhishma Pitamah, but at the same time, some introspection is needed how to go forward. Thank you very much.